बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, इट इज़ अवर लेक्चर नंबर 5 इन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ बिजनेस कम्युनिकेशन एंड रिपोर्ट राइटिंग, बीकॉम पार्ट 2। टॉपिक ऑफ अवर लेक्चर इज नॉन वर्बल कम्युनिकेशन। इट इज सेकेंड और एक्सटेंशन ऑफ द लेक्चर ऑफ प्रीवियस लेक्चर, लेक्चर नंबर 4, द काइंड्स ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन। सो नॉन वर्बल कम्युनिकेशन इज द टॉपिक विच वी आर डिस्कसिंग इन अ सेपरेट लेक्चर। वेल, वॉट इज नॉन वर्बल? वर्बल मीन्स ऑफ द वर्ड्स एंड नॉन वर्बल मीन्स विदाउट वर्ड्स। वेन वी कम्युनिकेट सम मैसेज without using words, it is called non-verbal communication. It is the use of body language, such as gestures, postures, movements of hand and head, appearance, eye contact, etc., to convey some message or to add to the meaning of a message is called non-verbal communication. So when we use these body signs, gestures, postures, etc., and movement of hand and head or body, or we use these things to convey some message or to add to the meaning of some message, we want to emphasize some message, it is called non-verbal communication. Non-verbal communication is very important part of oral communication. We cannot have oral communication without non-verbal communication. It is an essential part. It is an essential and natural part of oral communication. In our face-to-face meetings, conversations, non-verbal communication is as important as verbal communication or oral communication. When you are speaking, information, you can convey information non-verbally as well as verbally. And you see, in the playground, umpire usually uses the non-verbal communication to give his decisions. And on the part of the listener will also provide quick and immediate feedback through non-verbal clues or signals or gestures. When someone is listening, if he agrees to the speaker, he will nod. He will simply move his head and he will nod his head. And if he does not agree with him, he will shake his head. So this non-verbal communication is also called body language. It is called body language. Non-verbal communication is used unconsciously in our oral communication. While we are speaking, we sometimes shrug, we simply move our shoulders upward, or we move our hands or head. And while listening, we may nod, clench our fists, or grind our teeth. So these non-verbal clues or signals, they add impact to the meaning of our messages. Studies have shown that our body language or non-verbal signals or clues, they contribute to 55%, and the tone of your voice contributes to 38%, and the words you say contribute only 7% in the judgment of you. While when you are communicating some message, the receivers will judge your meaning mostly through the non-verbal gestures, clues, 55%, and 38% decides your tone, and 7%, only 7% is contributed by your actual words which you are speaking. The non-verbal clues may be discussed under the following headings, or these are the three main kinds of non-verbal communication. Number one is appearance, number two is body language, number three is silence, time and space. Well, we come to the appearance. Appearance means how a person, thing or surrounding looks. Appearance of anything or a person, place or thing. How it looks. Appearance in oral communication, you know the appearance of a person is very important. It has great effect. His clothing, hairstyle, neatness, jewelry, perfume, etc. are very important. Similarly, you will be impressed with the neat clothing, with the hairstyle or the perfume used by the speaker, and you will listen to him attentively. The appearance of surroundings, such as the room size, location, decoration, furniture, temperature and lighting, add to communication. They affect your mood, your minds. They simply contribute to a better communication. So all these things, they have an impact in communication, the appearance of surrounding in which you are communicating. And in written communication, the appearance of envelope, its size, color, weight, postage, impress the receiver and communicate something. For example, on the envelope there is a postal stamp of some foreign country. You simply get the message that this envelope has come from abroad. It is not a local letter, it is a foreign letter. Well, appearance of everything that is involved in communication process, that affects the communication. Second is body language. Body language is also called kinesics. It is called kinesics. It means communication through parts of body, such as head, face, hands, fingers, arms, legs, etc. In our communication, in our oral communication, while speaking, we use the movements, different gestures and movements of our head, our hands, our fingers, arms, legs, etc. We move around the room while giving a lecture. So this contribute to some meaning. In oral communication, body language is often more important than words. Sometimes your gestures convey more meanings than your words. Sometimes your actual words are saying something else, and your body language, your kinesics, is giving some other meaning. So the people will get that other meaning. And that is the actual meaning you want to convey. It gives precise meaning to your message. Without body language, your meaning, your message will not be conveyed exactly as you wish. So your body language gives it precise or exact meaning. Body language includes the following things. Posture. What is posture? Posture is the way people stand or sit. It can show their feelings, interest, self-confidence, status, etc. You see, the posture of an officer, army officer, and the posture of a common soldier will be quite different. So posture conveys messages. It conveys meaning. Well, facial expressions, human faces and eyes, they can communicate a variety of meanings, variety of expressions and emotions. A smile conveys good humor. When your face is smiling, it conveys good humor. It simply is conducive to good communication. And when you have raised eyebrows, it denotes questioning and disbelief. You want to question some, you want to put some question, or you are not believing in what the speaker is saying. A frown denotes upset or worry. When you are having a frown on your forehead, then it indicates that you are upset or that you are worried. Well, number three is gestures or body movements. Gestures or body movements, many gestures are used as we speak. For example, shaking a fist to denote anger. You shake your fist to denote, to express your anger. Using hands for emphasis. You use, while speaking, you use your hands to create emphasis on the point you are speaking. And in listening too, gestures are used like nodding in agreement. When you are agreeing with the speaker and you are listening to him, you nod. You move your hand in a nodding movement. And you shake your head in disapproval, in negation. You do not agree with him. Well, the next point is smell and touch. Smell and touch, these are also important. You see, fragrance, perfume, it conveys emotions to the receivers. When you are applying some good perfume, people will be receptive to you. They will simply appreciate you. And when you are applying some odd and repulsive perfume, or sort of ether, as you see in your society, so people feel repulsive. People will simply dislike you, and they will not be so much receptive to you, and the communication will be affected. Well, touch is an important tool to convey warmth, support, encouragement. You touch somebody to convey your warmth. You shake hands with someone and you simply shake his hands firmly. It conveys warmth. You pat somebody on the shoulders. It shows that you are supporting him and encouraging him. Touch on your shoulder indicates support and encouragement and comfort. You simply are creating comfort for people. But it is important to touch people only when it is acceptable and appropriate, because it varies from culture to culture. In our culture, hugging and shaking hand is very common. People like it. But in Western culture, people, when you don't have informal relation with them, people don't like so much hugging and so much shaking hands. Well, the next is voice quality and paralanguage. Voice quality is and sounds are also a part of nonverbal communication. They are called paralanguage, and the paralanguage includes voice volume, the volume in which we are speaking, the rate, the pitch, and other sounds such as throat clearing and sighing. These are included in voice quality and they are called paralanguage. So these things also communicate some meaning. They add to the meaning. So these are important non-verbal clues. Well, the third kind of non-verbal communication is silence, time, space, and color. Silence communicates. Silence seems to us as meaningless. We think that it is worthless, but it is meaningful. For example, if you send a request to some friend, or you send a collection letter to your buyer who bought something from you and did not make the payment in time, you send him a collection letter, but you receive no answer for many days. So you may assume that the reply is negative, right? When you receive no answer to your request for loan, you will assume that the reply is negative. So silence here conveys something. And you see, in Islam, silence when you ask some girl about a proposal and she keeps silence, then you may assume that she agrees to the proposal. Next, time is also important and affects communication. If punctuality, you see, punctuality conveys one's sense of responsibility, and if you are kept waiting for a meeting or for an interview for hours, you are kept waiting, you will be annoyed. You will feel that the company or the organization which has called you for an interview, they are simply not competent. They do not value time. So punctuality of a person conveys his sense of responsibility. And the study of time, this study of time, how we manage time, how we arrange time, is called chronomics. Space around us communicates. Space language is called proxemics. It is study of space around us, how we arrange it and what we arrange in it. It means, for example, how we arrange furniture in a room, how we arrange the location of different people in certain place. It is proxemics. For example, usually some people, or usually the bosses, they project or they express their status by occupying the best space in a building or in a hall. The boss will occupy the best space in order to show his superiority or in order to show his officership. Usually space between persons while talking, while in oral communication, is about 18 inches, but it varies in different cultures. Nowadays, the pandemic COVID-19 has simply created gaps or the between people, so it may vary from culture to culture and time to time. Well, color language is also important in non-verbal communication. Different colors convey different moods and behaviors, and you see, it also depends on different cultures. In different cultures, colors have different significance or different meanings. For example, black and gray convey a negative and sad feeling. A particular black coat tells you that a person wearing it is a lawyer. You see, in our country, people wearing black coat usually are lawyers. Blue and yellow convey positive feelings. White color is the symbol of peace and chastity. You see, it varies from culture to culture. If a Christian girl wears a white colored suit, it may be her wedding day. A Christian girl wears a white suit at her wedding day, on her wedding day. But a white suit worn by a Hindu woman, will show that she is a widow. So red and pink are the colors of joy and mirth. So this is how different colors convey different meanings and in different cultures. So it was our topic. Thank you, students.